Hey guys, it's Nicolette, and I'm going to do the recording of this module, which is Module 5, Industry Analysis and Competitive Advantage. Nita and I started it until, I don't know, until everything just started going wrong. So basically, I'm just going to run through it as quickly as I can and explain it as best I can. And if you guys have any questions at all, we can set up like maybe a Skype something. So that you guys can like ask me questions and stuff and to clarify. So industry analysis and competitive advantage. So basically these markets and these industries. So what is the difference? So like I was saying yesterday, a market is comprised of individuals and organizations who are interested and willing to buy a good or a service, and they want to get benefits because they want to satisfy a particular need, and they're also people who have the resources to engage in such a transaction. So a market is comprised of buyers. Who are the people who buy this good? So like you can be considered to be a market. I'm considered to be as part of the cell phone market because I'm a person who is interested and willing to buy a cell phone so that I can make calls, use the internet, which are benefits or particular set or like satisfy a particular need, which would be using the internet, making calls, and I have the money to get a phone. So, and I'm a buyer, so that is why markets are comprised of buyers. And then in an industry, on the other hand, it's a group of firms that offer a product or class of products that are similar and a close substitutes for one another. Because one example of this was that we shared yesterday was the dairy industry. The dairy industry, they do milk, they do cream, they do ice cream, they do frozen yogurt, and these can sometimes be substitutes for each other. So industries are comprised of sellers. These are the people who just they sell things. So when you want to when you're defining markets and industries, basically what you're doing is you're assessing the attractiveness of that market, of that industry. I was saying, okay, fine, Nita makes a really good curry. So if she's gonna decide, well, everybody likes my curry, let me get into making curry, and selling it to people. She needs to assess how attractive that industry is, which would be, let's say, the food or restaurant industry. So first of all, she needs clarity about which customers. So who is she planning on selling this curry to? Which needs is she catering to? Is it that they just want lunch on the fly? Is it moms who can't cook? Or is it just people who have developed an interest in Indian food and curry? Which sellers of which products are also to be included in the assessment? So she needs to decide, okay, who else is selling curry? Who else is selling something else that might be a substitute for curry? Okay, so moving on to the side. So markets are often defined both in demographics and geographic terms. So geographic is who? Who's buying? That's demographic. Geographic is where are the customers? And in terms of particular good or service demanded by the customer, you're going to categorize, them into three groups, which is firstly the generic category, product class, or product type levels. So these are the three levels that we're gonna have to define the demands or goods that we're gonna put the goods in for the different consumers. So challenges in, and we're gonna expand on that just in the slide. So challenges in market and industry definition. Okay, so markets and industries can be defined at several levels of analysis. There's a generic category, there's a product class, and there is the product type. And I think Nita yesterday, I kind of switched two elements. Okay, so a generic category level typically includes an array of non-competing products. In the book, it spoke about breakfast foods. If you're gonna say breakfast foods, gosh, you can eat a lot of things for breakfast. You could have muesli and yogurt for breakfast. You could have porridge, hot porridge. You could have cereal, cornflakes. You could have bread with beans and eggs and that sort of thing. So if you're like, we sell breakfast foods, I mean, you can pancakes, waffles, the whole lot in there. It's really generic. So now, product class. Products involved may serve diverse markets or market segments. The more generic the definition of a product class, the higher the aggregation level of the products. The more generic the product class is defined, the less useful it is for strategic planning, which seeks to identify opportunities and threats for specific product market relationships. Okay, so if we're going to put a product class, what I said yesterday was a product class would be like vehicles. That's a product class. Vehicles. Yes, it should be. I did actually explain it properly yesterday. It would be like vehicles. This is something that has a motor of some sort and gets you somewhere, right? But this is really wide. I mean, a vehicle can mean many things to many different people. It could mean two wheels on a motorbike or a scooter, which has slower engine than a motorbike. It could mean a truck, a double cab truck. It could mean a Ferrari, a sports car, it could mean an SUV, it could mean a tractor, you know. So product class just basically is like, it's like an aggregation, you know, it's a higher aggregation level of products, you know. And so it's very generic. It's like, oh, it's a vehicle, you know. Well, what kind of vehicle? Imagine the police say, well, my car was stolen. What kind of car is it? No, it's just a car, you know. Okay. So when you look at product types, these are subsets of product class that contain items that are technically similar, although they vary in such aspects such as appearance and price. So now we're going to say, okay, fine, we've got cars. What kind of car is it? You know, this is now the product type. Is it a convertible? Is it a sports car? Is it a station wagon? Is it a sports utility vehicle? Is it a truck? So now we're actually getting into the different aspects, appearance, we're getting into different prices. And most marketers select product type as their level of analysis for market planning because while such products within a product type may serve different subsets of needs, they are typically close substitutes for one another. So, the product type, I'm just now on this last bullet right over here. The product type level of aggregation is considered more sensitive than other levels to what? Okay, the product type level of aggregation is considered more sensitive than the other levels to environmental or to environmental changes that create opportunities or threats for individual product market entries. So basically, they're saying that when it comes to product type, it's slightly more sensitive to what's happening because we've spoken about macroeconomics, how that affects everything. And so product type aggregation, actually, we can see the impacts like more visibly. Like for instance, about 10 years ago, everybody wanted a big car and everyone wanted a big gas guzzler. And now with the environment, CO2, you know, more cars on the streets, people just want a small car that they can find parking with in the city, you know. And so there were two things that changed with the big gas guzzlers. One, the price of fuel just went up. You know, so that was an environmental factor, economical factor. And then two, people just became aware of the environment. They're like, no, but there's so much CO2 and it's ruining the environment and all of that stuff. So I think you guys kind of get where this is coming from. The danger in restricting one's market and competitive analysis to a particular product type is that other product types may be overlooked. Focusing on the true consumer need can help avoid this problem. So instead of saying we're a company that makes trucks, because somebody out there wants a truck, how about going to people and saying, well, do you actually want trucks? Do you actually want big gas guzzlers? Do you actually need a big car? And some people might say, no, we don't want a big car. We actually need a really tight, compact car. So that needs to be taken into consideration. So now when we get into this blue box over here, we're just going to be discussing how it actually affects everything, like how using these categories can affect your business or your marketing analysis or your marketing programs. Firstly, defining a market or industry at too broad a level can cause the analyst to overlook important market industry interactions, right? So basically, remember, the market is made of buyers, the industry is made of sellers. So the market and the industries, they interact. Just like when you, as the buyer, go to the car dealership, which is the industry, you guys are going to interact. So if you make it too broad, if you say, well, we're a company that makes cars, and like kind of like what Henry Ford did when he first built that car, that famous car, and he was like, you can get it in any color except as long as it's black. So they're like, we're gonna make cars and they're gonna be black. And they just basically said that was it, you know. If you do that, you can overlook some important factors to your consumers, things like them wanting a red car, them wanting a smaller car, them wanting a faster car, them wanting an electric car, because you're just like, we want to produce cars and we're just going to make a general car for everyone. On the flip side, let's look at the second bullet here is defining a market too narrowly can cause the analyst to miss potential important competitive developments. So you're, if you're so focused on this is our product and it only does this. Okay, here I'm going to use the BlackBerry example. We only make phones for business people and email and paging and whatever, you know, you miss other competitive developments. Hey, it's a touch screen. Move, like come up with new ways of like doing business, of like doing of you know of creating products that tap into your market. Look at new markets, you know. So I think I've basically tackled this. Took me a bit too long on the slide, but I think you guys kind of gist of it. Okay, so now thoughts on market and industry definition. A recent study found that managers tend to rely on supply-based attributes rather than demand or customer need-based attributes. Okay, so if you're gonna analyze an industry, let's say Nita wants to go into a curry business, one of the things that might happen is she might analyze the industry based on how many people she sees selling curry. So she could think, wow, there's nobody here selling curry, so I'm going to start a curry shop, which is what I feel like a lot of companies have done that. I've seen a lot of businesses going, oh, there isn't this thing, so I'm going to do it. And after I do it, I'm going to be the main person who has this thing, and it's going to be perfect, and everything's going to be nice. Instead of looking and actually wondering, well, the kind of market I'm in, do people actually want curry? Are they aware of, are they very familiar with Asian food, with Indian food? You might find yourself in a neighborhood or area where people just like fast food. They want McDonald's, they don't want curry. So that's a mistake a lot of managers tend to make. And furthermore, managers tend to identify too few firms as competitors and are likely to omit new firms or potential competitors. So sometimes you're like, oh, there are only three people selling curry, so definitely I can succeed in this industry. But you don't take into consideration that there was another shop that opened nearby. Maybe it's not selling curry, but it's selling something else that could be a substitute for your product. Maybe it's another fast food place. Or you don't consider the fact that, hey, you know what? I could have a potential competitor in another business who does something slightly similar. Okay, here I'm going to use Pick and Pay as an example because I know that Pick and Pay or like some of our supermarkets have cooked food sections. So you might be like, oh no, there are only a few restaurants that devote themselves entirely to Indian food. And then you go to Pick and Pay and then you find, oh, but here they're actually making curry and I can get the curry from my supermarket's cooked food section. So you often have stories of managers who know their business in quotes and they're surprised by, oh my gosh, we've got a new competitor. Oh my gosh, you know, like where did this person come from, you know? And I really should have removed that, the last part of this line, like from this three to here, it wasn't supposed to be there. So in conclusion, the best way to avoid ill-advised temptation or confusion over how broad or narrowly to define one's market and industry is to carefully examine both one's market, which we've spoken about. We spoke about the frameworks in module 4. Right? Yes, we did. And one's industry. Okay, moving on. So the market is attractive. What about the industry? So let's say you have a market that is attractive as heck. You know, you've got people who are interested in getting curry, people who are just they love Indian food. What about the industry? What about from a seller's perspective? Is it attractive? So an industry's attractiveness at a point in time can best be judged by analyzing its driving forces. So you're looking at things like critical success factors. What are the success factors that will make your business succeed? Because people liking curry, because like I love curry, does not necessarily mean that you should start a curry business and it's gonna work out. Because maybe I'm a once a month curry person, you know. And if you're to take a survey, ask people, wait, like, do you guys love curry? You'll get like 9 people saying, we love curry. We love curry. Curry's the best thing. But you find that those people love curry like once a month. So especially like, let's say you look into the restaurant industry, they tend to need to sell a number of plates to break even. So you need to look at the critical success factors of your industry. Next, to the degree in which the management can perform on these factors. So if selling 100 plates of curry is a critical success factor in that industry, you need to have management that is actually capable of selling that much curry. And then the next thing you need to look at are the five major competitive forces, which is Porter's five forces, and we're going to go into that. But before we get into that, we're going to talk. Let me just go through them again. So you're looking at long-term growth rate. You're looking at your key buyer segments, diffusion of proprietary knowledge, and changes in cost and efficiency derived from scale and learning effects and government regulations. So now, after these trend drivers, we're now going to go into Porter's five competitive forces model or whatever it's called. Okay, so basically here we've got competitive rivalry, we've got the threat of new entry, we've got supplier power, buyer power, threat of substitution, and basically this is where you're at. Like, this is where you're at. You're just like, you're here and you're struggling with your business. You know, you're struggling with against this competitor over here, the guy next door who sells hot dogs, the guy next door who sells curry. Sunita is basically here in the middle. And then the things that usually happen here that you need to consider with this here in the center with competitive rivalry is things like number of competitors. How many competitors are they? Next, quality differences. Like, what are the differences? So maybe she might sell more curry than the next guy because her curry's better and she doesn't skimp on her spices or her chicken in the curry. Next, we've got other differences. You know, these are small differences like delivery and little perks that make certain businesses, you know, more attractive to customers and the such. Then we've got switching costs. How difficult or easy is it for you to switch to another restaurant or whatever? And I remember I was talking to, like, for me, okay, actually, I was telling her about this ravioli. It's this Italian dish at a place called Cappuccino's, and it just changed my life. I don't know if you've ever eaten something that changes your life. Like, you actually, I find myself having a craving for the ravioli from Cappuccino's. So for me, the idea of me going and eating ravioli somewhere else, like, no, I'm not going to do that. You know, but on the other hand, if somebody's like, well, I know a restaurant where you can get ravioli for $30 cheaper, I'm going to think, oh gosh, you know, I better go check out that restaurant. Whereas if somebody else says, well, there's this other ravioli that's like $100 more, I'll be like, that's too steep a switching cost. I'm just going to stick here where the ravioli costs the right price. And then you also got customer loyalty. I think we all have brands we're loyal to. I am loyal to McDonald's fries, and I'm loyal to McDonald's milkshakes, and I'm loyal to Burger King's burgers. And I, what else am I loyal to? The vineyards that I'm loyal to, wine producers that I'm loyal to, ice cream brands that I'm loyal to. So that all does affect what happens in the competitive rivalry section. Here we've got threat of new entry. So this is basically the possibility of new people entering into the market. These could be strong competitors, weak competitors, you never know. So things that affect the threat of new entry include time and cost of entry. Is it easy for people to enter into the like, can they do it quickly? Can they enter into the market quickly? And is it expensive to do so? The knowledge, which is the, I think we spoke previously just about proprietary knowledge. Is there some sort of specialist knowledge that's needed for them to enter into the industry? Do they need to achieve economies of scale? Because, for instance, if you're going to be, let's say, in a restaurant industry, you need to be able to afford economies of scale. You need to be able to afford to buy in bulk so that you can reduce your prices. Otherwise, other people are going to be able to sell products, you know, that are more cheaper than yours, you know? And you need to look at cost advantages. Can you actually develop cost advantages and technology protection, which is kind of like proprietary diffusion of proprietary knowledge, because basically there could be a technology that's that helps, you know, make the product special, and that technology is not readily available. And you look at barriers to entry. What are the barriers of entry? Does the industry have barriers to entry? That sort of thing. Okay, so now we look at supplier power. So this is basically the people that get you your raw goods, that you or you sell or you produce or whatever. And with supplier power, you look at the number of suppliers in the market. Like, how many people are they actually that actually supply a good? Because you know what it's like? When there are fewer suppliers, they can charge whatever they want because, well, where else are you going to go? You also need to look at the size of the suppliers. Are they smaller? Are they bigger? I feel like if you have bigger suppliers, slightly hard to negotiate with smaller suppliers. You can kind of negotiate with them on terms and conditions. The uniqueness of the service. The suppliers that give you the services that you need, how unique are they? Can you get it from somewhere else? Or is it something that is so unique you can only get them from a particular person? And that also creates, you know, that factor where they can be like, well, you know, you're just going to have to get it from us because you can't get it anywhere else. And your ability to substitute, if perhaps a supplier stonewalls you and they have a really bad attitude, and you decide, you know what, I'm just going to use something else for this exact same, to manufacture this exact same product. Is it actually possible for you to do so? All right. So then we've got the cost of changing your suppliers. How easy is it going to be to change a supplier? You know, how painful, rather, will it be if you change a supplier? That's what we refer to when we're talking about the cost of changing. Is it going to be a big deal? Because sometimes you'll change a supplier, and then the way that they function, the way that they deliver, it upsets your production process because it's not quite the same, you know, and you might have a better time, you might have a worse time. So it's also dependent on that. Then we've got threat of substitution. This basically, this is a threat to your business because if you produce a product that somebody can substitute with something else, then you know it gets a bit dicey, you know. So you need to know how many substitutes there are. Like, I'm gonna give coffee creamer as a example here. You know, it's like the powdered milky substance. It looks like powdered milk, but it's not. It's coffee creamer, and people use it in their coffee. That has so many substitutes, frankly. You could just use milk for that because most people already have milk at home. You could just put milk in your coffee. You could use cream in your coffee, you know. So that will also affect how your company competes, because at the end of the day, you know, you have to be able to compete against people selling the same thing as you and people who are not selling the same thing as you, but it's similar to what you do, and customers can just get that instead. And also, you know, the cost of change. What does it really cost customers to change from your product to a substitute? Is it going to be worse for them? Is it going to be better? What's the deal? Okay, the last thing we're going to look at here is buyer power. So, how much power do your consumers actually have? So, when you deal with buyer power, you're looking at the number of consumers. If there are less consumers than there are suppliers or retailers or sellers, you can have a situation where the customer basically dictates the price. And they say, well, we have this amount of money, you're going to bid, you know, for our money, you know, and you tend to find like almost like a tendering process where people like 10 companies come, they're like, okay, you want this service or product, we can sell it at this price. Another someone else says we can sell it at this price. Someone else says we can sell it at this price. Just hold on, someone's calling me. Sorry about that, guys. Our cleaning lady wanted to get into my room and do some work, so I had to just move to my mom's room. So basically, the number of consumers or customers makes a difference, and the size of each order. Because, I mean, you know, certain consumers can buy certain things on bulk, and other consumers buy things one-one. Like, for instance, like Nito was talking about how, like, she sometimes buys things in bulk. I never buy anything in bulk. My mom buys stuff in bulk. And I've attributed that to the fact that I am very temperamental when it comes to using products. So I can decide to use this product today, and next week I'm like, I don't want to use this anymore. So I don't want to accumulate a large amount of a particular type of product and then find myself unable to change my mind, unable to use something else because I have used this product so much, whatever product it is. The other thing is you look at the differences between competitors, and when you talk about the differences between competitors, we've already spoken about, you know, the differentiation strategy, low cost strategy, and you know, and how do the buyers relate to this? Are you in a market when you've got so many competitors that, you know, switching is not an issue for your buyers? They're like, oh well, we're just gonna go to that guy. He sells the exact same thing you do. I mean, like something like this I'll look like at the hardware industry because like with me doing woodworking as a hobby, I am a little bit inclined to choose particular brands of, let's say, blades, like saw blades and that kind of stuff. But if I'm gonna buy nails, gosh, I'm just gonna go like, who's selling nails? Look for the right price, check out the quality. But I find so many hardwares are selling the same thing, you know? And then you also need to look at price sensitivity. You know, are your buyers finicky? Are they so powerful that if you just dare to increase your price, they're like, no, we're not gonna pay for it, and they just stop paying for it and they let go of your product. Like, so that's something you need to consider. Ability to substitute is something that I believe I just touched on. Is it easy for them to find a substitute? And what about the cost of changing? Does changing from your product to another product cost them anything? Is it going to be painful for them? Is it going to be inconvenient for them? You know? So, yeah, I think I just about explained this as best as I could. Next, I'm looking at rivalry among present competitors. So rivalry occurs among firms that produce products that are close substitutes for each other, especially when one competitor acts to improve its standing or protect its position. So suddenly, let's say that Nita is selling her curry, and then the shop, which is like a block away, buys this huge billboard which says the best curry in Klerksdorp, you can get it from here, you know, and then she's gonna be like, well, now I need to do something. That's when their rivalry is going to start. So rivalry is generally greater under the following conditions. First, there is high investment intensity. That is the amount of fixed and working capital required to produce a dollar of sales is large. Okay. Now, when I would talk about high investment intensity, I would actually look at the probability that, okay, fine, let's say Nita sells a bowl of curry for 20 rand, which is like, it's like less than 2 euro, right? How much of that 20 rand is going to be capital and how much of it is going to be profit? So it's entirely possible that the bulk of the 20 rand is capital. So basically, you've spent, let's say, 16 rand to get 4 rand profit. And when it's like that, basically, when your working capital or your investment is greater and you're getting very little in return when you sell a product, there's going to be greater intensity because you're going to be like, oh, heck, that means that I need to sell more products. So that I can like get, I can break even. The other thing that causes rivalry is when there are many small firms in an industry or no dominant firms exist. Because then it's like all of you are just kind of like trying to get a piece of the pie. Everyone's small business just in a hurry. Need to get this pie. Need to get this pie. Okay, we need to get the pie. And then that's when there tends to be a bit of rivalry. Whereas if there's a big main competitor, then it's kind of like, there's very little rivalry, in that they already own most of the market. They already have most of the shares, and you guys just kind of have to, make do with whatever the little you get on the side. And it also happens where there's little product differentiation. So let's say Nita sells curry, Nahar on that side sells curry, Saloni on this side sells curry, and yeah, the recipe is slightly different, but it's not like, oh my gosh, there's a huge difference. There's going to be a lot of rivalry because it means that any one of them could get that sale. And usually it happens in industries where it's easy for customers to switch. So somebody could be like, ah, I'm going to get curry from Nita today. Ah, I'm going to get it from Saloni tomorrow. Oh, I'm going to get it from Naha tomorrow. So that's how rivalry tends to occur among present competitors. Thing. Okay, so high, rivalry is high, leading to high consumer churn, and is unfavorable. So, in other words, if you think of going into the cell phone industry, dude, there is so much competition there. So it's actually unfavorable. There's just too much rivalry. But then, because of this rivalry, you consider the fact that products are different. Because they have different features and services, and customer switching costs are low. It's not actually that hard. Well, I don't know. I suppose maybe that was in 2010. In 2016, changing a new phone is kind of hard, hey? Because if you're going to spend $500 on a phone, a new Samsung Galaxy S, whatever, and an iPhone 6, whatever, C or S or whatever, I think that, customer switching costs would be a bit higher. So anyway, so basically they're saying that when you look at rivalry among present competitors in the cell phone industry, rivalry is high, leading to high consumer churn, and therefore it's unfavorable. So the cell phone industry is unfavorable, and this has to do with the fact that products are differentiated and customer switching costs are low. It's really easy for somebody to switch. So there's high rivalry because it's so easy for somebody to say, here's a new cell phone concept, come buy from us. You're like, ah, okay, fine. That is their logic. When you look at the threat of new entrants, it's low because the threat of new entrants is low. So it's moderately favorable. You know that if you get into the cell phone industry, you're probably going to have to tussle it out with people that are already there. But from the perspective of, of new people coming into the industry and upsetting things for you, it's moderately favorable. Okay, so the rationale is while rapid pace of technological change may bring new entrants based on new technology, packet switching, satellites, blah blah blah, new service providers must purchase a bandwidth license by spending billions. So basically, what is stopping new entrants in the cell phone industry is that, for the cell phone industry, they need to, what? Mobile phone service industry. Oh, right. Sorry. I now realize what they're talking about. They're talking about the people that provide your cellular network. So in SA, that would be your telecommunications company that services your phone. Here we've got Mascom, we've got MTN, we've got Orange. I don't know in the U in Ireland what's there, but maybe you guys have like Orange and stuff. So basically, oh, that's why they said customer switching costs are low, because it is quite low. You just for us, we just get a new SIM card. Yeah, okay. I see now why they're saying threat of new entrants is also low, because it's hard to get into that kind of industry where you provide mobile phone services to people. All right, okay. And the new service providers must purchase a bandwidth license, and that's going to cost billions and billions. And also they have to set up the technology and the infrastructure, the cell phone towers. So that is going to be quite expensive. Supplier power. Supplier power is high, so that's moderately unfavorable. So governments in developed markets have raised the price of additional bandwidth through auctions. That is so mean. Shame. Next, buyer power. Buyer power is low, which is favorable. Even large customers have little power to set terms and conditions in this industry. It's kind of like the way that your cellular service provider will tell you that it costs 1 euro a minute to make a phone call. You really can't negotiate that and say, well, no, I want to pay less. You just have to pay what they're charging you. So in that way, yes, our buyer power is quite low. And threats of substitute is high, which is moderately unfavorable. And to look at PDAs, laptops using Wi-Fi networks to access the web, could cannibalize expected sales of 3G wireless network mobile phones. Well, I would actually put this more, I get the way they're talking about internet, I would more put it as a threat of people using another alternative like WhatsApp to make phone calls, and say, oh, you're going to charge me this physical amount, like these cents per minute. Well, I'm going to use WhatsApp and I'm going to talk for 4 hours on 1 euro, whereas you would have charged me 1 euro for 1 minute. Okay. So, okay, now we're looking at, I think this is just an expansion of what we've spoken about. So, the greater the threat of new entrants, the less will be an industry's attractiveness. And this usually happens when sorry. Okay, so we have strong economies of scales and learning effects. Okay, we've actually already spoken about that. If the industry has strong capital requirements, so it would be harder for new entrants to come in if there are strong economies of scales and learning effects that are present. If the inquiry has strong capital requirement at the outset, because some people just won't be able to afford to get into that industry. When strong product differentiation exists, that means anyone else coming into that industry needs to make whatever product they have really, really different to get attention. And if gaining distribution is particularly difficult, if it's going to be hard for you to find shops to distribute your particular product, let's say you come up with a new cell phone called the Faraz. Okay, you'll forgive me for that. Faraz, the Faraz, our cell phone is the Faraz, and the company was started by Faraz, so we want to sell this really cool cell phone called the Faraz. And now you need to go to people who sell cell phones and you need to convince them to stock your product, and that can sometimes be difficult. Okay, next, the bargaining power of suppliers. So, supplier bargaining power is increased on the following conditions: if the cost of switching is high, if the price of substitutes are high. So, if you're gonna, if for instance, you need chicken to make a curry. And the price of getting a chicken substitute, maybe turkey, is also high. You're just gonna stick to chicken. And also, if supplies can realistically threaten forward integration. Why would they threaten forward integration? I'm gonna need to go back into this actual question for myself. Forward integration is when they can threaten to buy. Oh. They can threaten to do what you're doing. That would suck. It's kind of like the way Apple has now set up Apple stores and they sell their own products, whereas before they had to sell to in stores. Well, there are some stores that are still carrying Apple products, but predominantly, if you're gonna buy an Apple product, you're gonna buy it straight from an Apple store. So I think that's an example. And when the supplier's product is a large part of the buyer's value added. So imagine if chicken is a really large part of chicken curry. So if the supplier knows that you're selling chicken curry, and they also know that it's hard to get chicken parts elsewhere, they can be like, well, you better pay what we're asking, otherwise I don't know where you're gonna get your chicken from. Next, you look at bargaining power of buyers. Buyers play individual supplies against one another in the efforts to obtain concessions. So I don't know if you've ever done this, but I know that like there are stores here, and I'm sure there's stores in South Africa that do the same way. They say they'll beat any price. So you'll go to one shop, you'll see, let's say, the price of a laptop. You'll go to another shop, you'll see the price of a laptop, and then you're gonna be like, well, you know what? At that other store, it costs this much. I'll put pressure on the supplier and say, you know what, we can reduce the price for you to get it to that price. That's what we talk about when we say they place individual suppliers against one another in an effort to obtain concessions. The extent to which buyers succeed in their bargaining efforts depends on, obviously, buyer concentration. How many buyers are there? The switching costs that reduce the buyer's bargaining power. Maybe it's hard. It's really hard to switch. I think one switching cost that a lot of people can identify with, let's say in terms of appliances, if you have a big stove and and you bought it and you've been using it for years working fine, the idea of getting rid of the stove, first of all, if it's a built-in stove, that means that you're going to need to bring in some guys who know how to dismantle it, take it out, then you're going to have to maybe rebuild the place where it was, install a new one. You might just think, I should just stay with my stove. The other thing is the threat of backward integration. Like, is it actually possible that your buyers will be like, you know what, to hell with you. We're going to go straight to your supplier and get this in bulk. And then we've got the product's importance to the performance of the buyer's product. I think we've spoken on, it's kind of like a flip side of what we just spoke about in supplier power and buyer profitability. That's very important because if a buyer is struggling to be profitable, after you sell them a particular thing, like if it's going to be a part of some sort of manufacturing process, then you need to take that into account. If they're gonna be, you can, because it's kind of hard to squeeze money out of a rock. It's kind of hard to squeeze money out of a place where there is no money. So that's gonna be one of the factors. Then obviously we've got threats of substitutes. So substitutes are alternative product types that brands can perform essentially, that product types that can perform essentially the same function, such as plastic bottles versus aluminium cans. Margarine, Olay or margarine versus butter, faxing of documents versus overnight express delivery. And substitute products put a ceiling on the profitability of an industry by limiting the price that can be charged, especially when supply exceeds demand. So we're talking about here is if the price of milk goes up. No, I shouldn't use milk because milk has other things that's used. That's useful. Okay, yes. If the price of coffee creamer goes up, right? People will be like, I'm not gonna pay 10 euros for a packet of coffee creamer. Milk is 5 euros. I'm just gonna start using fresh milk. So the fact that milk, a substitute, is at a certain price level, it makes it really, really difficult for the original product to say, fine, I'm gonna charge double what the substitute product costs, because then they're just gonna go and all move to the They're just all gonna decide to move to the substitute product. Okay, so the next thing we're gonna talk about is changing competition and industry evolution. So let's start off with this on the side. All five competitive forces just discussed are affected by the passage of time. Therefore, their strength varies as the industry passes from its introductory stage, this growth stage, to maturity, followed by decline. So, competitive forces are apt to be weakest during the fast growth period. Thus, there are substantial opportunities for gaining market share. Because think about all of the things we've talked about in the competitive forces. We've spoken about buyer power, supplier power, substitutes, things like, competitive rivalry. What was the last thing? I forgot what it was. But basically, if when we've been analyzing all of these things, have you realized that a lot of them tend to be factors that are similar to factors of a mature stage of an industry? We're talking about, if you're talking about substitutes, if they're already substitutes, it means probably that other people have entered the market. We're talking about rivalry. We're talking about how there's differentiation. There's quite a bit of differentiation. There are lots of competitors in the market. We're talking about suppliers. We're talking about buyers being picky, choosy, buying substitutes. And it's no longer when an industry has started, when things are new and fresh and flashy. It's kind of like, oh, we're kind of settled in, and now we're fighting for a bit of stability. We're fighting for what's left. So Competitive forces are weakest during the growth period. During the shakeout periods, competitive forces are at their strongest, and many competitors are forced to exit the industry. During maturity, oh yeah, the other one is new entrants. During maturity, competition typically slackens, but only if an industry ho leader holds a strong relative share. An industry will experience more price competition during maturity if the leader holds a weak relative share position, because he's still something to fight over. And a declining industry usually witnesses considerable rivalry, the extent of which depends on the strength of the exit barriers and the rate of decline. Next, we're looking at critical success factors. Who wins within an industry? Remember, it was one of the first things we spoke about, critical success factors, whether management can actually bring about these success factors. So critical success factors are what differentiate between success and failure firms within an industry. And these obviously differ from industry to industry. So these factors, looking at the bullet points on the left, these factors are often concerned with one or more elements in the marketing mix. So they're often concerned with the product, you know. So we're looking at capability to generate successful new products. That's a critical success factor. Can they actually create new interesting products that people want to buy? Next, looking at price, is it possible for them to be a low-cost producer? You cut down costs, you make more money. Next place, can they obtain widespread product distribution and promotion? Can they develop strong relationships with large customers or with the large segment of their market? So I moved on to the blue box. Assessing the fit between an industry's critical success factors and the presence of those factors in a firm or proposed management team is a good way to assess whether an industry is attractive to that particular firm or management team, and to determine whether that firm or team is likely to be attractive to investors or other suppliers of resources. So basically, you need to look at what are the success factors. What kind of products do I need to have? What kind of prices do I need to charge? What kind of distribution? Where, what kind of place do I need to put my product into? And what kind of promotion do I have to do to really, you know, sink my teeth into this industry? And does the management team I have actually make that possible? And will people actually believe in the company enough to actually invest in us? The next thing we're looking at, rate of diffusion of innovations, which is another factor in assessing the opportunity attractiveness. So obviously, we're looking at the right now. Diffusion of innovation theory seeks to explain the adoption of a product or service over time among a group of potential buyers. So this basically has to do with how easy is it for people to adopt or take interest with and get used to whatever new product or service we are offering. And a lack of awareness and limited distribution can typically limit early adoption. So if people don't know that you're offering this product, if they can't even find it, it's going to be difficult for them to, you know, to get used to it, buy it, show it to other people, and get other people used to it. So you need to have large amounts of awareness, large distribution. Next, as positive word about the product spreads, the product is obviously going to be developed by additional customers. I think you've had that experience where you got a product, like with me and my iPhone. It's like, oh, I got an iPhone, and I tell every single person, like, oh my gosh, you won't believe what my phone did today. Oh, this is so cool. I have this new feature. So diffusion theory is useful to managers in predicting the likely adoption rate for new and innovative goods or services. And this also has to do with you being able to predict maybe your cash flows, because no one's going to put something out there in the market and expect that everybody's going to want it, everybody's going to think it's perfect, and they're going to immediately have a, you know, turnaround profit. Because what's usually going to happen is you might need to go into a period, a prolonged period of, you know, of not getting a lot of money in, of not breaking even until, you know, it's widely known, like your product is widely known. So now we're looking into the blue box. So before entrepreneurs or established marketers invest in the development and introduction of an innovation, they should evaluate how rapidly the innovation is likely to be adopted by the target market. Okay, I'm going to give an example of something that I think everyone's going to understand. Flatbread, the Indian flatbread, the roti, or let's say chapati. Let's say that some person has invented this machine that will just make chapatis, 20 chapatis in 5 minutes. Now they're going to go and try and sell it to, you know, to Pakistanis, to Indians, and, you know, and they basically need to consider to themselves, how fast is it going to take for people to hear about the product, buy it, and figure out how to use it, and thereby start telling people, oh gosh, I've got this new chapati making machine. It makes like 20 chapatis in 5 minutes, and it's so easy to operate. Whereas if you create a product, the chapati machine is very complicated. It comes in 10 different parts, and each time you make the chapati, you have to put the 10 parts together, then you have to disassemble them, then you have to wash each and every single one. That might affect the rate of adoption by the target market. So the second point, the faster the adoption rate, the more attractive. So if it's something that's really quick and easy to learn, it's going to be much better for you to launch that product versus something else that's going to be difficult. For instance, I don't know if you've ever watched a lot of these home channel network, whatever, the shopping channels, where they're trying to sell you something. Usually it's like, it's so easy. It's 1, 2, 3. It's 1, 2, 3. So practically by the time you buy it, you already know how to operate it. So yeah. So the faster the adoption rate, the more attractive and innovative good service is to a marketer, as competitors are caught short while customers build loyalty to the new product. So if you invent something that's really easy, it's like split second for people to like figure out how to use it, by the time your competitors are like trying to create a product similar to it, your customers have already developed loyalty to your brand because they know your brand. Okay. So I'm just going to quickly go through the two definitions of the adoption process. So the adoption process involves the attitudinal changes experienced by individuals from the time they first hear about a new product and service or idea until they adopt it. So first is awareness. So let's say the first time you heard about an iPhone, it's like, oh, there's something called an iPhone. Oh, okay, that's well. I know it's now out. I haven't seen it. Then there's interest. That's when you see someone with an iPhone. You're like, oh, an iPhone, cool. Can I take a look at it? Can I just look at it? You know. And then there is evaluation. You take a look at it, and then the next thing, you know, maybe you go online and you read about the specs of an iPhone. Oh, its camera has this much resolution. Oh, it can do this. Oh, there's a personal assistant called Siri. And then you're like, you know what? I think maybe I can try it out. You know, and you get an iPhone and then you try it out. And at first, you know, the first few weeks when you have a new phone, it's kind of like, I'm losing my mind. I don't know how it works. And then finally you've adopted it and it's fine and it's perfect and you know how to work it and you know all the tips and tricks and you say to your friends, hey guys, everybody should get an iPhone, you know? The next thing we're looking at adoption rate. So what is adoption rate? Okay, so if plotted on a cumulative basis, the potential of people adopting a new product over time resembles an S-curve. Although the curve tends to have the same shape regardless of the product involved, the length of time required differs among products. So the adoption rate is not going to be like a straight line shooting up, you know, like on a graph, you know, but it's going to kind of be curvy, wavy, you know, like there's going to be a heightened, like, awareness. Maybe there's going to be marketing, the interest are kind of, it'll be low, it'll be not that much, and then people are going to try it, and then people are going to start raving about it, people are going to start talking about it, and then people are going to start buying it, and then people are going to, you know, that sort of thing. So refer to your textbook, because I think I put the graphs in here. Sorry about that. I actually should have put the graphs in here. So now they're talking here about adopter categories. So these are categories of people that adopt certain technologies. So we've got innovators. They're like 2% of individuals that ultimately adopt a new product. These are the people who, as soon as the new thing came out, they bought it. Like, they didn't wait to see if anyone else bought it. They didn't wait to see if it crashed or anything like that. That's me with Windows 10. I just got it immediately and now I regret it. So they're more likely to be receptive to new ideas and tend to have high incomes, which reduces the risk of loss arising from an early adoption. And yes, because they tend to be the people that have money. Unfortunately, Windows 10 was free. They tend to be the people who have money. So that's like, oh, cool, that's cool. I'm gonna buy that and try it out. Whereas somebody else might be like, I don't know if it'd be worth my money because I have a limited budget. So that's tends to be the difference. And we've got early adopters. These are like 13 to 14%. You know, they're more part of the local scene. They're often opinion leaders, you know, and serve as vital links to members of the early majority group, because they're social proximity. So let's say this would be the people who got Windows 10 because they were my friends, and because I was like, oh, Windows 10 is pretty cool. Hey, I just upgraded to it and it wasn't that bad, you know? So these would be early adopters and they're influenced by me, right? No, wait. Service vital links. Oh, and then they have like the early majority. Okay, fine. Sorry about that. So let's move to early majority. These include 34% of those who adopt. These individuals display less leadership. So then these would be people who adopted it. Okay, fine. These would be the people who don't adopt a technology until like somebody, they see someone else holding the phone. And they're like, oh, that's a cool phone. That's interesting. Yeah, no, yeah, I got it recently and you know, it's really cool. They're like, oh, okay, that's fascinating. I think I'm gonna get that phone, you know. I'm gonna try it out. I've seen quite a few people I know have it, so I think I'm gonna try it out. And they tend to be active in community affairs, thereby gaining respect from their peers, and they don't like to take unnecessary risks and want to be sure that a new product will prove successful before they adopt it. So these are people like, oh, okay, so how well do you know, does this feature work on it? How well does that feature work on it? And they're like, oh, can I try it out? Can I take a picture with it? Because they want to make sure, because they don't want to waste their money. And then we've got the late majority. Frequently, these individuals adopt a new product because they are forced to for economic or social reasons. It's like how everyone has a smartphone these days. We call, you know, those phones that don't have WhatsApp, that WhatsApp can't work on. In Zim, we call them goats. So, like, you've got a goat, right? Because it can't WhatsApp. And I remember this time I was teasing my mom that she had a goat. And yeah, she wasn't very happy about that. So they're forced to change basically for economical social reasons. Then we've got laggards, you know. I mean, of all the adopters, they're the most local. They participate less in community matters than members of other groups, and they stubbornly refuse change. It's like everybody's like, oh yeah. So this is kind of like my mom with the smartphone issue. She did eventually get the smartphone, but not to call it that, but just take pictures while she went on holiday someplace. So these are the people like my mom who are like, I don't need a smartphone. A smartphone for what? I use a phone to make phone calls and to send text messages and to run my business. That's what works, you know. So they stubbornly resist change, and in some cases they adopt a product so late that it's already been replaced by another new product. Because like for instance, the phone that my mom, that I convinced her to finally get, it was like one of the cheapest smartphones we could get that was actually smart, like legitimately smart. And now, you know, I kind of look at her phone, I think, oh man, she could be using something else, you know. She could be using an iPhone. So yeah. Next, the implications of diffusion of technology theory for forecasting sales of new products and new firms. I think I spoke about this early on. It's a good way to estimate how quickly an innovation is likely to move through the diffusion process. And basically, you construct a chart that rates the adoption on the six key factors. And we're going to talk about those. And an innovation that is risky for the prospective buyer to use or try or buy has little competitive advantage, or is complex or is incompatible with current user behavior and is difficult or expensive to try or to understand its benefits, is likely to face tough criticism regardless of the attractiveness of the industry. I would say this is kind of what happened with hybrid cars when they first came in. It was like, oh, you can charge with electricity and you can have it, you know, with fuel. And people are thinking, where are we going to charge it? Is it like something where we put in our socket in our house and we plug it in? And then it was like, oh, you actually have to have a particular port which you can put in your garage. And it's like, oh gosh, how's that going to work? And what happens if I run out of, what happens if I'm using fuel first and then the fuel runs out and then I'm on electricity and then it runs out? Where am I going to charge it, you know? So it was very risky for buyers to try, because also they had to get rid of their current car, you know? It was okay. It was a little bit complicated, I suppose, to understand, because I feel like using a fuel car is very simple. You put the right amount of gas, step on the accelerator, you go. If you run out of gas, you're going to find a place where you can also get gas. You know, it's different from finding a port to charge your electric car from, and it's difficult or expensive to try. I know that some of these hybrids are not cheap at all; they're quite expensive. So, and I remember when they first came in, people were like, "Oh, and look at the design of the car," and that sort of thing, because you know these cars were designed to be quite efficient, fuel efficient, electricity efficient, very light cars. And people were like, "Oh, we don't trust this car. We don't like the design. Is this all they have in this hybrid thing?" So it took a lot of time for let's say a car like the Toyota Prius to just to gain traction. So this is a comparison chart of the rate of adoption of cellular phones and personal computers for home use. So the risk factor, they say for mobile it was moderate because mobile phones were given away to attract early adopters who agreed to 1 year's usage. So I suppose if you mitigate risk by offering it to people, giving them a chance to get used to it, perhaps there's moderate risk. Home computers was an expensive investment. I remember like getting a computer back in the day. You know, if you read about it, it's like, oh my gosh, it costs thousands, you know, to have this thing, and it's huge and it's bulky. So the relative advantage of it is that it enabled people to make and receive phone calls from everywhere, in their car or at the beach. Now with home computers, like, so what are we using this computer really for? You know, I believe computers are mainly for people who wanted to do, who are some sort of programming or that sort of thing. You know, they weren't for the average ordinary person at that stage. When you look at relative simplicity, another adoptive factor. Early mobile phones were easy to use. These days they're so complicated, almost a headache. PCs were very difficult and very complex to use. Okay, when we look at compatibility with current behavior, I'm sure for mobile phones it was fine because people were already making phone calls at home. They had a landline. Now for computers, I believe people had to learn a lot because sometimes you don't really spend a lot of time on a computer. Your dad says, "Oh, I'm gonna buy a computer for the home," and you're like, "For what? What am I gonna use it for? I don't even know how to use it." The ease of small-scale trials, okay, to let people try out the product before they buy it. So contracts required only modest minutes of use. With home computers, one could visit a store for a hands-on trial, but couldn't understand the bits, bytes, and RAM. I remember that was so confusing. Okay, and when we look at ease of communication of benefits, obviously it's easy to sell someone a cell phone and say, "Hey, you can make phone calls from anywhere." But on the other hand, saying you need a computer, it's like, for what? So the benefits were not easy for them to explain. Okay, now we've moved on to sustaining competitive advantage over the product life cycle. So the product life cycle is considered the sales history of a product or product class. The concept holds that a product's sales will change over time in a predictable way. The same way that if a company introduces something interesting, you're going to see maybe lots of people trying it. So the industry's growing, lots and lots of people are trying. After a while, they get used to it, and then it kind of matures. And then after a while, people lose interest in that thing. And products go through a series of five distinct changes, which are introduction, growth, shakeout, maturity, and decline. So each of these stages provides distinct opportunities and threats, thereby affecting the firm's strategy as well as its marketing programs. Because obviously, you're going to have a different strategy and different marketing for different stages of the life cycle. So here we have a generalized product life cycle. So here we've got, what have we got here? Okay, here we've got the okay on the bottom we've got time in years. So we could say that the introduction phase, like year one, year two, year three, year four, year five, and then profit in dollars is measured by the yes, profit in dollars, product category sales, and all of this stuff. This is like I'm trying to figure out how to explain this. like what's going on in my mind. Okay, so basically, let's look at the line that is broken off, right? So as you can see in the introductory stage, at first the line dips down into the bottom because nobody's making any profit because people are still trying to figure out, okay, what is this product? So at that time, you're kind of spinning wheels, trying to get people to know what your product is. Eventually, it starts going up. So we're looking at the broken line, right? Starts going up. You start making profits because, okay, the solid line, which you see, is the line of like, it's measuring like, I believe it's measuring units of product sold or your product going out, you know, or manufacturing. So as you grow, you're making lots and lots of product and then lots and lots of profit. And then when you get to the competitive turbulence phase, which is like the shakeout phase, you know, it's now getting really tough. Certain people are not making as much money as they should be making, which apparently, according to this graph, is you. And a few people now, you know, like the profits aren't as high as they should be. You know, certain companies are having to go out of business. Let's say competitiveness made you all lower your prices because you wanted to compete on price. And then, so the profit steadily starts going down as the product matures. People are not buying as much of it as they used to. But I would actually categorize this as maybe if a new fast food joint opens up, it would have a profit trajectory that looks like this, because when you introduce it, not that many people know, and then it starts going above the, not going above, it starts. Okay, let me use this pointer. Okay, here, as you can see, the pointer here. When you first introduce it, no one knows about it. You're not making much of a profit, and then as you continue in the introduction phase and into the growth phase, your profits are getting higher and higher and higher. And then when you get into the competitive turbulence phase, people are now competing. You know, people are now trying to, they're reducing prices, they're promoting lots of things. So now your profits come down a bit more because there's now a bit more competition. And you get to maturity, you've lost some of your other competitors over here. You know, they just left the industry or the business or whatever. You're still here, but you're not getting as much money here, as much profit, because it's not a new product that people are excited about. Probably they're excited about something else right now. And, then obviously now you go into decline, so your profits are going lower and lower. So here we've got life cycle extension. So what usually happens here is, let's say you start off introduction, growth, competitive turbulence, maturity. It's about to go down, and you introduce something that sets your product back on a upward trajectory. Maybe you include a new product, benefit or an innovation, and then just as you're about to, as it's getting, you know, to a stage where it's, you know, growing, or shall I say, it's like it's at this stage, if you look, it's almost like I guess you'd say like the growth stage, competitive turbulence stage. This is where you'd now make another change, create another product, and then start again to like have higher profits, revitalize your product line, shall I say. So these are the S curves. Yes, so we're talking about how they tend to be like an S curve. This is like an S curve. So it all starts like here at the bottom. These are unit sales. So you know, nobody's buying, people start buying, people start buying. You're in the growth phase, and then you know, you get into the, you know, bottom up here, create turbulence stage, maturity, and then sales are going down, sales are going down, sales. And then let's say you introduce something else, an improvement. Oh, sales are going up, sales are going up. Maybe there's a shakeout. Oh, sales are going down, maturity has occurred. So this is a cycle recycle. This is a growth decline plateau. This is an innovative maturity cycle. Oh, new product, very interesting. Oh no, we're going to decline. No, we're introducing something new. Yay, we're making more money. Oh no, looks like this product's gonna go out of fashion. Oh, we've introduced something else. This is a classical unit. Oh no, a classical life cycle, product life cycle. Basically, it goes up, growth, shakeout period, maturity, decline. So I think you're gonna have to study this own to really get like comprehensive understanding. So market and competitive implications of product life cycle stages. What we're going to look at is these are the different stages: introduction, growth, shakeout, mature and decline. We're going to look at stage characteristics. So in terms of market growth, it's moderate. You've just introduced it. And then it really goes high. It grows and grows and grows because people now know about it. Your awareness has increased and probably your it's easy for people to learn to use a product. And then we've got the shakeout. So, you know, your market growth is leveling out. By this stage, when it's mature, you know, people have now chosen their customer loyalties, their favorite brands, that sort of thing. And obviously, in decline, you just start losing market share. Okay, so technical change in product design. This is high. This is like here, you're all putting your innovation and your ideas and everything into play because, you know, you want to create something interesting and fascinating. When you get into the growth stage, people are getting used to what you've already created. So you don't want it to shock them with like, oh, we're also changing something else. No. When it gets to shakeout, it's limited. You guys are fighting over promotion, this sort of thing. So you're not really interested in shaking things up by doing something new. As you reach the maturity stage, it's the same thing. You're not going to change anything significant in the product design. And obviously, in decline, you ain't changing nothing. In terms of the segments, very few segments when you first introduce it, usually, again, like we spoke about, they're those adopters that immediately, like, grab onto something, you know, and they're like, oh, we want to use this innovation or whatever. So these are the few. And then the few to many, you know, will be like the next level, the 13%. I'm like, okay, this is interesting, let's try it. Shakeout period, yeah, people are like, okay, fine, more people are trying it out. They're trying it out. And then here you've got more people trying it out. The industry is now mature and it's kind of leveling off. Most people probably already have the product or service. And here, people start to stop using it. Maybe another product comes into the market or another substitute comes in, which makes it even more better, which is better than the other previous segment. Okay. With competitors, you have very few competitors when you introduce something. When you start growing, people can say, oh my gosh, you're making money. You're going to have a lot of people getting in into the industry. Now, when it's not in the shakeout period, the people that got in and their hearts weren't in it, they're going to start being shaken out. By the time you get here, you're going to have very few people. Only the firms that were worth their weight in gold will still be here. And then, obviously, in the decline, some people are going to harvest, some people are going to sell out, so you're going to have very few there. Profitability, like I said, there'll be that bit of negativity. People are still like trying to figure out, okay, fine, do we even want this product? Some people don't even know about the product, so that certainly affects this. In the growth stage, large, because more people are finding about it. More people are buying it. Shakeout level low because you know what? You guys are basically trying to survive and seeing who's going to survive the industry and hoping that you don't get cut in the shakeout. Here it's going to be large for high market shareholders. The companies that stuck it out and managed to survive this phase. Those are the people who are going to be here and they're going to have large profits. And in decline, no one's going to be making much profit because, well, the industry's in decline. People have moved on to other things. Okay, this is a continuation. And in this stage, we're talking about responses at different stages of the product life cycle. So we've got strategic marketing objectives. So the important thing is to stimulate demand. It's like to get somebody to know that you're selling curry. And then here, you're about building share. So you want to grab as much of the market shares there. People now want curry. Now you want to make sure that you grow your share of the market so that you hold on to them and so that even if someone else comes and wants like sell curry, like people are gonna buy from you. And then you're gonna continue to build share here in shakeout. And I believe that happens because as people are leaving the market, they're leaving their competitors, not their competitors, their customers, and you'll be able to swoop down. And then here at the maturity stage, you just need to make sure that you hold on to your market share. And then in decline, you're gonna harvest. Now you're just trying to make the last few pennies that you can from the industry. Okay. So product responses in each stage. So here you're trying to make a quality product that will just wow people and blow them out of the water. When you get to the growth stage, you're just doing more quality improvement just to make sure that, your competitors aren't catching up with you. When you reach the shakeup phase, now you're just like, you know what? I think what we have is pretty good. Like, we're not going to be improving more things. We have a pretty solid product. Here, you start concentrating on like features that make it more convenient, shall I say, for people to use. So it's no longer like how can I explain this? God have mercy. I'm trying to think. My voice is getting hoarse, and like we're no closer to finishing this. I don't even think we would have finished it in like 3 hours if we're doing it by ourselves, like if we're together online. Right. So here you're concentrating more on features and benefits and getting people like focus like what can I say? You're getting people to focus on the benefits that are currently there and adding maybe a little bit more convenience features, things like customer support and that sort of thing. And in decline, you're not going to change anything. With product line, when you first start off, it's really narrow because you know what? You're trying to focus all your resources on people getting used to this thing in the first place. And then as you go into growth, you make it broader, you start increasing things. When you're in the shakeout, you just, you might start cutting a few things out here and there, getting rid of some things that are not making profit in your product line. And then here you just hold, you hold on to your product line, try and try and what can I say? You hold on to your product line. You're trying to basically maintain the strength that it has. And then here you have to reduce the length of your line. That means you're going to reduce even more products that are not being profitable anymore. Just hold on, I'm being called. Okay, I'm back. So now we're looking at price. So basically, usually when you introduce something at first, you're skimming versus penetrations. Remember, your penetration pricing is when you like charge really, really cheap prices because you're trying to get people to try your products. On the other end, you can charge slightly higher prices because you want your product to be associated with higher quality or exclusivity. And then what's going to happen in the growth stage, you're going to reduce a bit because other people are also entering the market, so you're going to reduce your prices slightly. The shakeout period, you're also going to reduce your prices because you want to remain the business that actually still has business. After all is said and done, you actually want to survive in the industry. And then when you're at the maturity stage, you're just going to hold on to your price levels, or you can reduce it a little bit here and there. You're going to choose which one that you are going to which one you're going to focus on. On reducing the prices. And then obviously in decline, you're reducing the price because you just want to get rid of what you have and the business. You're going out of this industry. So you just need to make as much profit as you can. So now when you look at channels, basically this is distribution. Who's selling your product? At introduction, you can't really like you can't really distribute to everybody because not everybody knows who you are. Remember, you have to convince people to actually carry your product or your service. So, at this stage, you need to be very selective about who you're actually allowing or who you're asking to or who you're giving your products to. And then, when you enter the growth stage, there are more people who are now interested, more customers are interested. So maybe they're going and they're asking people, hey, do you have this product? And then suppliers, not suppliers, retailers are coming to you and saying, hey, can we have your product? People are asking for it. The other thing is, okay, when you get into the shakeout again, you want to have as much extensive coverage as possible, you know? And hold on. Yeah? Is it locked? Okay, I'll come and unlock it for you. I just need to go and unlock the cleaning lady. Where was I? Oh, yes. So during the shakeout period, you want to have a lot of distribution because you want to be the person who's going to survive. The only way you're going to survive is if people continue to be able to get your products out there, if people continue to be able to buy your products, if people continue to show preference for your product over the other person's product. The same thing, happens at the maturity level is, now you're just trying to hold on to your market share. So you need to be in as many places as possible in where people expect to buy your product from. And then obviously if you're going to decline, you're not producing that much of the product anymore. So you're going to be phasing it out slowly but surely, depending on, on who, on depending on which of your few select segments still require the products. I think there's some products that they even when they're going to decline, there's still a few people who still want to buy it. So they want to make it available to those who still want it until almost to the end. And when you look at communication, at introduction, it's high. They want people to know where the product's at. Growth, high communication. In fact, all of it is high, until, you get to the maturity stage where it's like now, you've basically gotten most of the market share that you want, hopefully. And then obviously in decline, you reduce it because there's no reason for you to spend marketing dollars on an industry that, is in decline, So, okay, let me continue this after I go and open the gate for the claim lady. Okay, I think I had just about finished explaining everything. So we spoke about how communication remains high throughout the first three stages and into a little bit of the fourth stage, which is maturity, and it starts going down when you're in decline. So when you look at marketing mix decisions at the different stages, which is what we're going to be going into. So let's say at the introductory stage, okay, product. So the length of the product line should be short to reduce production costs and hold down inventories. And efforts to establish competitive advantage are typically focused on differentiating the new product. I think that's practically self-explanatory. With pricing is affected by the product's value to the end user, how quickly it can be imitated by competitors, the presence of, okay, this actually should have been a point of its own, how quickly it can be imitated by competitors, the presence of close substitutes, the effect of price on volume. This is elasticity. So when we say price on volume, we're saying there's price elasticity of demand, which basically says that how much demand a product commands or has is going to be dependent on price. So if you increase the price of something, usually the demand for it goes down. If you reduce the price of something, usually the demand for it goes higher. So this is also important. And on cost. And basic strategy choices involve scheming and penetration. We've spoken about this. When it comes to distribution, which falls under place, distribution decisions can vary widely depending in part on whether the new product is intended for consumer or industrial markets, or whether with a mass market appeal or a niche focus. Okay, so achieving distribution is particularly important with consumer goods because of the large amounts sometimes spent on promotion to make consumers aware of the product and to induce trial of the product. So let's say somebody who wants to compete with Hanes beans is like, look, it's Nikki's beans. Let's say I open a bean tinning thing. It's like, oh, it's Nikki's beans, and I tell everybody about Nikki's beans. People can't find Nikki's beans anywhere, and that makes it extraordinarily difficult because I've spent all this money on advertising, but people can't find the product. And distribution is easier to obtain if the company enjoys established channels for its other products. So let's say before selling Nikki's beans, I was selling Nikki's rice, and I was selling Nikki's olives, and I was selling Nikki's tomato paste, right? It's easy for me to go to the shops that hold my rice, my olives, and my tomato paste and say, hey guys, I've got a new product, because they're already holding other things that I sell. When it comes to promotion, expenditure involving advertising and sales force is high because you're trying to really cash in on this market. You're trying to get people to become loyal to you before your competitors swoop in. So the communication task is to build awareness of a product's uniqueness, and promotional expenditures such as in-store displays, premiums, coupons, samples, and off-list pricing are required to obtain product avail wait. Are required to obtain product availability and trial and are substantial. something like that. I don't know what I was typing there. Okay, for industrial products, the time required to develop awareness of a product's uniqueness is often extensive due to the number of people in the buying center and the complexity of the buying system. Because I suppose the thing is, if you're going to be selling an industrial product, you're not going to put an ad on TV that says, "Buy your sugar processing equipment from us," or something, because most of the people aren't even in that industry. With industrial products, you're going to go like the personal sales force kind of like way of promoting things, you know, sending people to businesses to speak. Okay, marketing decisions in the growth stage. So in the growth stage with product, your product line expands to attract new market segments. Because remember, you launched in your first small segment, and now you're launching other things that you can attract new segments. And you offer an array of prices and different product features. With pricing, it tends to decline during the growth period, and price differences between brands decrease. And the extent of the decline depends on cost, volume relationships, industry concentration, the volatility of raw material costs. Basically, what are how? No. I was about to say something silly. Basically, the prices of the raw materials that you use. How are they stable or are they unstable? That's going to affect your pricing as well. I think we're talking in one of the previous sessions with Faraz about how we're talking about cocoa beans, chocolate, and how everybody loves chocolate and how everybody is blaming Nestlé, who doesn't even farm chocolate, for the rainforest being destroyed. And you tend to find that you know, if the price of a raw product, let's say cocoa beans, goes up, then what's also going to go up is the price of chocolate. I believe the price of coffee is going to go up soon because I've heard rumblings that, you know, the world is facing a coffee shortage. And I remember when I heard that, I was like, oh my gosh, I should buy more coffee and store it. So yeah, it depends on that. And sometimes growth can be so strong that it outpaces supply, and there's little or no pressure on price because sometimes everybody wants your product, but there's no pressure on you to actually reduce your price. I think a great example of this is iPhone. Have you ever realized that by the time they launch the next phone, they have like millions of people who are ready to buy the product. They're like ready. They're just like they're in position. You know, they're dying, you know, to like purchase that product. When we look at place, okay, both industrial and consumer goods strive to build a channel or direct sales system that provides maximum product availability and service at the lowest cost. If this can be accomplished, rivals are placed at a disadvantage, even to the extent of being excluded from some markets. So basically, if you're quick enough and you put your product in these stores enough, there might not be space for anybody's brand. Like anybody else's brand. So your competitors could go to your channels and say, "Hey, we've got this product. We also have it." And they're like, "Well, you know, we really don't have any shelf space for that." And because I don't know if you've ever noticed, but if you go to wholesalers, you find a whole, I'm going to talk about candy. You find a whole lot of like options for candy that, you don't find, let's say, in your standard supermarkets. So that's because I feel like maybe they turned them away and they said, "No, we are not going to stock this. We already have enough chocolate bars, lollipops, and the such." So that's actually put those other sweet sellers at a disadvantage. And obviously, on a wholesale level, they're going to be selling for a lower profit. So that's definitely a bigger difference. As far as promotion goes, you can sort of building demand for the company's brand. Like for that particular, for your, for Nikki's products versus Nikki's beans, you know? Because you're striving to build favorable attitudes towards the brand on the basis of, you know, our brand's unique features. And communications are also used to cultivate new segments, you know? Like, I feel like at this stage, in the growth stage, you're kind of like, "Hey, so you've tried out our beans, right? And you liked it. Did you know that we also sell rice and olives and tomato paste?" something of that sort. Anyway, and even though promotion costs remain high, they typically decline as a percentage of sales. So, marketing decisions in the shakeout stage. Okay, with the product, the firm must rationalize its product line by eliminating weaker items. Okay. With pricing, they emphasize creative promotional pricing. With place, they strengthen their relationship channels. Right. I think that pricing headline there also tackles promotions. Basically, it's more about, you know, getting people to come and buy based on low cost. And let's just look at the blue box on the top right, left-hand corner. The advent of this period is signaled by a drop in overall growth rate and is typically marked by substantial price cuts. As weaker competitors exit the markets, stronger firms gain shares. Okay, let's look at the blue box, which is on the bottom right-hand corner. To a considerable extent, what happens during a shakeout has been predetermined by how well each brand has been positioned in relation to its target segments, its distribution system, and its relative cost per unit. So basically, what happens in the shakeout depends on, well, what, you know, the strength of your position in the minds of your target segments. Are they like, okay, this is my preferred brand of tomatoes and paste and beans and this sort of thing? Am I conscious of the fact that if I go to any store, I'll find Nikki's products there, and the price basically stays very stable? You know, so basically it's like the shakeout stage, what's gonna decide whether you're gonna stay or you're gonna be shook out is the work that you did in the previous stages of the product cycle. My voice is going hoarse. This is like 1 hour and 30 minutes now. This is hectic. Okay. Marketing decisions in the mature stage. So any significant breakthroughs by R&D or engineering that help to differentiate the product or redirects its costs will have a substantial payout. So here in maturity, things have kind of settled down. People have dug down deep. Like every single person who could possibly, probably get a share of the market has it. So now you're just trying to differentiate. You need to add value to the products that benefit the customers by improving ease of use, by incorporating labor-saving features, or by selling systems rather than I was lost. Okay. When you say selling systems, we talk about, let's say, a whole process of doing things. Oh my gosh. How can I put this? Okay, instead of selling a single product, what if you could sell products that work together as a system? Okay, let's say I had an example in my head. It's completely fled my mind right now. Okay, since we're talking about curry, I don't think curry is a good example to use because I need an entire system. All right, yes, I remember my concept. Okay. Presume you're selling lasagna, which is pasta, right? Your company that sells lasagna. So what you're going to do is you could produce something that complements the lasagna as a recipe, maybe some sort of sauce or some kind of cheese sauce. Or rather, let me think of another example. I saw this in the store and I wanted to tell my mom about it. Okay, there's a company here. No, in South Africa, that makes beer. They make alcohol. And so what they basically did was they started selling barbecue sauce, marinade for meat that's going to be cooked on a braai stand or on a barbecue, because in Southern Africa particularly, there's a high correlation. If you're going to have a barbecue, you're probably going to be drinking beer. The two things go hand in hand. You're going to be eating meat that has been barbecued. Or if you're drinking beer, you're going to look for roasted meat. So now this company is selling a product that's almost like a system in that, oh, why don't you buy beer? Oh, you're probably going to be cooking brying meat or barbecuing meat, why don't you also get that thingy? So it's like you're trying to like create products that kind of work together in a system instead of one single product. Okay, in many services, in many product classes, service becomes a way of differentiating the offering. Okay. So a lot of times, like I think that's the difference between my internet and all the other service providers' internets, that the service is just better. Okay, pricing. The price premium attained by the high quality producer tends to erode because the market is kind of like maturing. The effect of experience on costs and prices becomes smaller and smaller and smaller, because it's like before you started off at the introductory stage, you had learning effects you probably figured out earlier than your competitors who entered at a later stage, how to, benefit from costs and efficiencies from your learning effects. But now, it's matured, the industry's matured, so there are fewer and fewer savings. Next, competition may force prices down, especially when the two leading competitors hold similar shares and they're both trying to get more market. So what they're going to try and do is they might start trying to cut prices. Okay, place. For consumer goods, distribution and in-store displays become increasingly important, as does effective cost management. Promotion expenditures tend to remain stable during the mature stage, but the nature of promotion is apt to change. Media advertising for consumer goods declines, and in-store promotions, including price deals, increase. So at this stage, they're probably going to start putting adverts to tell people, hey, come buy Nikki's beans. Hey, come buy Nikki's beans. And so what they're going to do is they're going to set up in-store promotions. Hey, 50% off on Nikki's beans. And then, yeah. Okay, so the next thing is marketing mix decisions in the decline stage. So at this stage, products tend to enter the stage because of something new has been created, a technologically superior substitute, or shift in consumer tastes or values or beliefs, whatever. And that's why your product is going in decline. That's why it's declining. So prices tend to remain stable if the rate of decline is slow. There are some enduring profitable segments, and there are low exit barriers. And customers are weak and fragmented, and there are few single product competitors. On the other hand, aggressive pricing is apt to occur when decline is fast and erratic. So basically, if the decline is going slowly, you're going to keep your prices the same. Now, if it's going downhill like really fast, that's when you guys are just like, we need to charge the lowest price that we can get out of this market as soon as possible with as much money and just get rid of these goods. Okay, so when this happens, usually there are no strong, unique segments and there are high exit barriers and a number of large single product competitors are present and customers have strong bargaining power. Okay, when we look at place, centers of distribution persuading intermediaries to continue to stock the item even though they may not promote it. So at this stage, you're like, well, just keep it. You don't have to advertise it or put in-store promotions. Just keep it in case anybody wants it. And okay, for industrial products, the problem may center on maintaining the interest of the sales force in selling the item. Because if you're in decline, nobody's going to be interested in selling something that's in decline. So that would really suck. So let's look at the blue box now. Some brands find it necessary to harvest any limited value that remains in the brand or even withdraw it from the market. Harvesting or withdrawal has as its objectives an increase in cash flow that can be accompanied by milking, which is making only in essential investments, internal transfer of assets. When you talk about internal transfer of assets, let's say you've got a production line. You're going to, let's say, move it to, let's say, okay, fine. Let's say Nikki's Beans is going down. It's in decline. So I am going to, let's say, well, I introduced a very interesting brand of jam, and that's kind of working in the market. So, and it also gets sold in tins. So I'm going to transfer my factory equipment for beans to the jam section. And we could sell the business or its assets. So I think that's harvesting or milking. Basically, just trying to get the last drop of money out of it. In any milking operation, management looks for ways to reduce assets costs and the number of items in the product line. Okay, so the strategic implications of the product life cycle. So basically, the product life cycle is a framework that signals the occurrence of opportunities and threats in the marketplace and in the industry, thereby helping the business better anticipate change in the product's strategic market objective, its strategy, and its marketing program. Basically, it helps you decide what you're going to do. It's going to say, okay, fine, should we change our strategic marketing objective? Should we change our strategy? Should we change our marketing program based on what's going on? You know, this is something we've been talking about, especially just now we're discussing like how the four marketing P's, the four P's of marketing will be affected by the product life cycle. So, first bullet point, by considering the stage in which a product sits in the PLC, one can identify the most typical responses that the marketing decision makers make to change circumstances faced by the product. So, I mean, just by looking, oh, well, it's an introduction and growth phase. Okay, probably they're doing a lot of a promotion. Probably the prices are quite high. Okay. Second bullet point. However, generalizing from such typical responses to those necessary in a particular situation is fraught with risk. So you might say, well, obviously the price is high. They're in the growth stage. And then, you know, you realize that, yeah, but then this is a low value item that people don't feel like they have to buy for such an expensive price, and that might not work out. Okay. Next, the third section, the product life cycle's major weakness lies in its normative approach to prescribing strategies based on assumptions about the features or characteristics of each stage. This was not written in English. Basically, what they're saying is that the product life cycle's major weakness is that the way that it's presented may give you this image in your mind that all products are going to go through that phase of, you know, you start off at introduction, not much is going on, and then the curve is going to go up until it reaches maturity, and then it's going to go down because that doesn't always happen. But you might believe, well, that's how it's going to work out. And it fails to take into account that the product life cycle is in reality driven by market forces. And these market forces express the evolution of consumer preferences. So you might design a product that you think is absolutely normal and not normal, absolutely fantastic, absolutely great, absolutely awesome. And you know, you introduce it and it starts going through this growth spurt. And then the next thing, something completely different, some sort of something that is completely, I don't know, whatever, interesting, different, comes in and your product immediately goes into decline. It doesn't even reach the shakeout stage. It doesn't reach maturity stage. The other thing is technology. So, you know, there could be a change in product. You know, you could be on this great trajectory. Someone comes up with a new technology which completely blows your trajectory out of the water. And competition, the supply side. Who else is doing what you're doing? What if your competition, I don't know, has so much power that whatever they're selling, even though it's not the same, it's kind of like if you try and introduce a new product and your competitor's selling something else, I feel like they can also, if they're large enough, can discredit you and say, well, say to its customers, oh no, don't pay attention to that company. That product's never going to work out. That's the way that I see this. So Mary Lamkin and George Day, I don't know if we'll even remember their names when we're in the exam, argue strongly that greater emphasis on competitive issues helps to better understand the evolution of a product market. This is especially the case in understanding the dynamics of competitive behavior in evolving market structures. So, in other words, we should focus on competition to understand how the product market changes. Okay. So these are the content questions that were in the back of at the end of the module, which hopefully we'll be able to answer. So what are the major forces driving the competitive environment? So we looked at buyer power, supplier power, new entrants, competitive rivalry, and the threat of new substitutes. What are the various levels at which product can be defined? We had generic, we had product class, product type. Okay, what is meant by the product life cycle concept? I think you guys can explain that. What are the characteristics and implications of each of the product life cycle stages? I think everyone can answer that now. What are the strategic implications of the product life cycle? I think we spoke about, you know, like how you might have to change your marketing strategy, your 4P strategy based on which stage you're in. What are the major limitations of the product life cycle concept? I think we spoke about how it tends to provide a normative assumption that that's the way that everything's going to work out. It doesn't take into consideration consumer trends, changes in consumer trends, changes in technology, and what your competitors are doing. And we talked about the adaptation process. We talked about somebody becoming aware. Oh, wow, there's this product. There is Nikki's Beans. Okay, Nikki's Beans. And then interest. Oh, Nikki's Beans. I want beans for breakfast. Yeah, I want to try beans for breakfast. And then there's evaluation. Now, okay, let me look at the packaging. Okay, it looks interesting. It doesn't look cheap. You know, the price is pretty steady. And then there's trial. And then it's like, okay, I'm going to try the beans. And then afterwards, there's adaptation. You know, it's like, oh, yeah, we like Nikki's Beans. We're going to keep buying them. Okay. So these are the thingy. Oh, and then there was one that was supposed to be a bullet, that 5.8. What is the adoption rate a function of? Which I'm going to need to go back and remind myself. What are the various adopter categories? You know, we spoke about, I've forgotten them. I know they were innovators. I know they were laggards. I know that they were, I know the first two. Off the top of my head, I'm going to have to go back and read them over. And which major forces determine industry competitiveness? This industry competitiveness might be the five forces, and the one on top might be just the driving forces. The trend driving forces, which we need to go back and look at. But guys, this is just basically a rundown of module 5. I hope you guys enjoyed it. If you guys didn't understand anything, holler back at me and we can chat, Skype, whatever, and I'll use my phone and we can figure this out together.